Verse 26. I want to read from verse 26 to 38. Verse 26 to verse 38. Verse 26 to verse 38. It says this. And in the sixth month, an angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, of a virgin's name Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou art highly favored. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. And he shall be great, and he shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then Mary said unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren, for with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. Verse 38 one more time says, And Mary said, Behold the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Father, we bless you again. Just ask you to breathe on your word. Make it alive for our lives, oh God. Be glorified in such a way, God, that it would be relevant, Father God, for every day of our life. You would manifest yourself, glorify yourself. Thank you for your anointing to destroy the yokes, bonds of the heavy burden. Show yourself strong and you get the glory. We thank you for this season. We thank you for this time. We thank you for who you are and what you're doing and how you're going to do it, Father God, with us, in us, and even through us, that you would get all the glory and the honor, even now, in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We continue in our series, and our series is this for this season, and even for our holiday season, is this. All God wants for Christmas is you. Say it with me.
All God
wants for Christmas, is you. Matter of fact, do me a favor. Turn to your neighbor and tell them, by the way, neighbor,
why you shop?
Why you cook?
Why you eat?
Remember this.
Is you.
I mean, you got everybody else on your list. I wonder if Jesus is on your list.
I know
we're going to go a whole lot of places and do a whole lot of things and spend money on a whole lot of people. And sometimes I should say, not even that important to you, but just so that you can have a gift if they have a gift for you. The truth of it is, even if you didn't think about them, God has been thinking about you all of your life. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
When it comes to this wonderful season, the celebration of the coming of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, we're celebrating the idea of the advent of Christ, the coming of the Son of God. We're celebrating the Messiah and our Savior. He is still the reason for the season. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And the coming of his kingdom, his king and his kingdom. Isaiah 9 and 6 says, For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. He's a wonderful counselor, mighty God, Prince of Peace, everlasting Father. He's come to celebrate him. The word becoming flesh and dwelling among us, full of grace and full of truth. Say, full of grace.
Full of grace.
I don't mean no harm, but just like them cats that was locked up, the only reason that you're still here is only because you got grace.
Yeah.
Which means you really didn't get it. We didn't deserve it. We just got favor because he loves us. We're forgiven because of his love toward us and his honor and his power and his favor, that not because of us, but in spite of us, he loves us and sends us Jesus.
Right.
So if you're going to celebrate all Christmas, you might want to take a few moments to give Jesus some worship.
Yeah.
challenge him becomes the idea of his grace and his love toward us, and how much he loves us during this season with unmerited favor and power and honor toward our life. That also, he says, not only with grace, but also with truth, because he is the way, the truth, and the light. His word is truth, and in him, it dwells in him and helps us become everything we're supposed to be. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Challenge over this is as we continue to mature and move toward Christmas. The reality of it is that all God wanted for Christmas was to save us, was to love us,
yes,
was to deliver us,
yes,
was to forgive us, was to heal us,
yeah,
was to restore us, was to cover us, was to bless us, and was to put us back in relationship with himself.
Yeah.
Think of nigga, by the way, all God wants for Christmas is you.
Is you.
The ability that the God Almighty was willing to come in humility, make himself a baby, get in the family, take on a body, live in humility, grow in maturity, live for me, serve for me, then hang on a cross for me, die for me, go to hell for me, and get up for me.
Yes.
Maybe, just maybe, during Christmas, I might want to break out into worship.
Yes.
You know you've been forgiven, stuff been wise, and you know you were guilty, and you should be on that picture that just showed, but you're not.
Yes.
Maybe somewhere in me might say, thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
And I might get a lot of stuff, but ain't nothing better than forgiveness.
Yes.
I won't get a gift that's better than grace. I will not get a gift that's better than love. I will not. Matter of fact, I found out the older you get, the best gifts you really want, like a peace of mind.
Yes.
That in the light of everything else, that in the midst of us hanging those lights, remember that he is the light that came into the world. That he came in the dark, light that came in the darkness and comprehended it not. Remember that while you're looking at all those beautiful gifts, that he is the gift of God. That the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life.
Yes.
That in the midst of hanging up that wonderful, beautiful tree, don't forget that tree called Calvary. I like the green one, but that red one blessed me, man. That red one took care of me, man. That red one got rid of my guilt, my shame, my anger, my sin, my past, my history. I'm good to go now, man. I found out that Christmas is not just about presents, it's about having an open heart.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, this is some gift suggestions we might got for you. This Christmas, if you're going to give somebody something, give your enemy forgiveness.
Yeah.
You're going to give somebody something, give your opponent tolerance.
Yes.
Give your friend your heart. Give your customer your service. Give all your family love.
Come on.
Give a child a good example and give yourself some awesome, good, old-fashioned respect.
Yes.
Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
While you're hanging them bugs, don't forget he's hanging blood for you.
Wow. Wow.
While we seek him, while we focus on searching after him and pursuing after him, remind ourselves of his value in our life and to our life, that all God really wanted for Christmas was our gifts. Yeah. Amen. 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 Amen.
Neighbor.
Have you given your gifts to Jesus?
Have you given your gifts to Jesus?
Not at Christmas this year.
Oh,
how about your anointing? How about your gifting? How about your calling? The gift that's on your life. Have you kept it to yourself? Matter of fact, have you unwrapped the last gift he gave you?
Wow.
Maybe you still got in the box called self. Because
yeah.
See, if nobody else benefits from your life, you might still got you all wrapped up.
Yeah.
I bet somebody said one time, they said the best part of preaching, the hardest part of preaching is this, making sure God get past the preacher.
Yeah.
Hallelujah anyhow.
Yeah.
I'm going to stay out of his way too. Hallelujah. Amen. Matter of fact, it's a reminder that I think as you get older, man, your Christmas gifts get smaller.
Yeah.
Yes. Because you begin to pray for stuff that nobody else can ever give you.
My God. Yes.
Amen. You know what I'm talking about. You feel like that materialism is good. Ain't nothing wrong with it. Amen. I like that celebration. I like all that. You know what I mean? It's the moment. I like all that. But it's true, no matter all that's going to go, the next day you're going to be sitting there going, you know what? What will this really do for me?
Yes.
See, I need a gift that's going to last beyond Christmas. You know what I'm saying? I need
know what? If that figure is still there, yeah, it's still there. The blood still works, it still works. Yeah. Because the prayer still works, it still works. Does it still love me? Yeah, the love ain't going nowhere. Tell your neighbor, by the way, Jesus is the only gift.
Jesus is the only gift.
Keeps on giving.
Come on now.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Because you know, you might go to the mall, but you ain't never went to Hellfire. You might go to Costco, but you didn't go to Calvary. You might get somebody a gift, but can you be a gift to somebody else? When's the last time you gave yourself as a gift? Come on. What if God was trying to give you as a gift to one of your neighbors, a gift to one of your coworkers, one of your gifts, and God said, well, go over there and do this for me.
Ooh,
Lord. Sometimes we are our own hindrance to our own gift.
Yes.
Somebody say hallelujah anyhow. Look. I know you might go online, but you'll never flatline for me.
Yes.
But Jesus was willing to do all of that.
Yes.
For all of us.
Yeah.
Tell you my neighbor, excuse me while I give him a good shout. This week we're going to talk about something. We talked about Joseph last week, the idea of having the spirit of Joseph. But there's another part of Christmas that's really important as we head toward that week. And I want to get the premise of the idea of the people that are around Christmas that help us understand what we ought to be doing around Christmas.
Come on. Yeah.
There's a lady that's there. She's a bad lady. Her name is Mary.
Wow.
And sometimes Mary, watch this, doesn't always get the preference and the celebration that she should get. Because the truth of the matter is she's a great picture of the church as well as believers. See, Mary's ability, watch this, to have the word come to her, but even more, she has the word in her.
Yes.
And then she don't even keep the word in her, she allowed the word to go beyond her.
Yes.
What's terrible is to come to church and always want somebody to give you the word, and you can't get the word in you.
Come on.
See, it's one thing to say, I need a word. Where is the last one you got? And how has that affected your flesh? How has it matured in you, grown in you, and become so much in you, you got to release it into somebody else's life? And if not, you just have a church, but you ain't having a Christmas moment. Because availability is better than ability to God. Yeah. God does not begin by asking about our ability, but only about our availability. And if we will prove our dependability, he'll increase our capacity. Say love. Mary's life shows in incredible ways that God can use us and use me if we surrender to his availability. That Mary's prophetic in the fulfillment of the Messiah coming in his presence. She's a portrait of the church and the idea of the earth and the idea of the word coming. She's also a picture of the idea of a believer that receives the word Jesus and the idea has him in his life. Then it develops in his life. Then that word has to come through your life. Say, come through it.
Come through it.
It ain't enough for you to come to church and the word get in you, but it don't come through you. If this is somebody else or they experience the word you got.
Yes. Yes.
It got to go beyond my flesh.
Yes.
See your neighbor.
Yes.
Could you stop being selfish with your Jesus?
Yes.
It comes to the place that we got to take responsibility to share Christ outside of us and to be able to walk in a place of surrender, being humble, to avail ourselves to Christ and his purpose. It means, matter of fact, available means to be suitable for something. It means to be available for something. It means to be able to avail yourself to process and purpose, to service to him, to become like our life becomes an entrance for Jesus to have access to other people's life. Does Jesus have access to other people's life through your life? Ooh, could you be Mary this Christmas? Could somebody else benefit from the Jesus you receive? And you related him with so much that now you received him and he's grown and matured in you, then now you can release him to somebody else's life. Tell your neighbor,
yeah.
I wonder if you will be married
this Christmas.
Availability does not start with ability. Availability does not start with ability. Matter of fact, most people God chose, they were available, they weren't anointed. Matter of fact, most people God chose, they struggle with their inabilities, and he knew that all I needed was somebody available to me. You see, when we chose Moses, man, I didn't ask you to talk. I just said, I'm going there. Are you available or what?
Yeah.
See, sometimes, watch this, he didn't even worry about it. Matter of fact, we mess up because we keep thinking about our authority, our ability, our power, our gift, our time. He said, I need to based on your authority, your power. As a matter of fact, he makes people apostles because they're available. And he can be present but not available.
That's right.
So you go to church all your life, but if you never served on any ministry, you was present but you wasn't available.
That's right.
So if you just worship every Sunday, but if you never helped nobody on the ministry, what you were present but not available. Okay, praise God. Pastor, gonna move on. Praise God. Amen. So the challenge becomes also this: is there? Listen, it means the ideal. Can I give God room to work in my life and through my life? Could I be married this Christmas and really know that Jesus has come and received Him, but also be able to keep Him to the point that He matures in my life, that I release Him through my life? Or could you really be experiencing a miscarriage when it comes to your faith? You got the word, but it stopped with you.
Oh my God.
You see, wherever you got the word and it got to your life, but it stopped at your life, miscarriage.
Oh my God.
You are having a stillbirth. The baby came, yes, he showed up, but it stopped where you are. Nobody else benefits from your forgiveness. Nobody else benefits from your grace. It stopped with you. You became a pool. You were supposed to be a conduit of Jesus, but now you're a block to Him. Mary's a bad somebody. See why he might want Mary now, dead.
Yes.
Come on.
You do know the first rule of availability is, can you get past you?
Woo, my God. Jesus.
See, sometimes when it comes to availability, it's not nothing about our, we tend to look at our weaknesses. God just wants to know, are you willing to go with it?
Yes.
Are you willing to just show up if I ask you to show up? If you aren't going to be where I ask, if you just walk in obedience with Him, you can see the glory of His authority with Him at any time. If He can do this with a virgin, with a woman, watch this. This is messed me up about this story altogether. With me. The Bible says this. It says He came to Nazareth. Say He came to the hood. Sometimes challenge becomes the definition of being that process and helping us out. Mary teaches a class on availability. There's like no other. How to let Jesus in your life, keep Jesus in your life, allow the Christ in, watch this, to grow in you and change you, and then be able to take that same Christ and release Him outside of you.
Yeah.
Sometimes in church we get stuck.
Yeah.
You got Him, but don't nobody else get Him from you.
Super.
And then Mary checks it out because when she's willing to have Jesus in the midst of her relationship, even if it means interrupting my relationship.
Come on.
You do remember she hooked up with Joseph, right?
Yes.
Could Jesus interrupt her relationship? I know he's cute. I know he's fine.
Yeah.
She got going on. But if Jesus shows up and says, "Dang the one." Could you follow me now? Could you trust me now?
Yeah.
Even though you had your own plan, can I help you interrupt what you got going on for my plan?
Yeah.
And could you really be my Mary this Christmas? I know you was Roman, but can you go back? And I know you was neat, but can you stand? Can you do the opposite when Jesus shows up? Because when Jesus shows up, some kind of stuff begins to stop. Can you allow your life to be an instrument for God this Christmas? Can you allow your life to be a part of His purpose this Christmas? I mean, I know the family coming over, but when they see you or Jesus this Christmas?
My God.
The Bible says in the sixth month, Gabriel was sent to her in the place of Nazareth, who was a virgin spouse of a woman, the spouse of Joseph, the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And those, and watch this, what I know about this is, no matter where you are, don't ever think that God can't use you.
Listen,
the whole text reminds me of this. It says this: He went to Nazareth, knew where she was, knew who she was hooked up with, and never, watch this, allow any of it to bother him. Now, in our times, it sounds simple, but back then, women were property.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, a young woman in immaturity too? Come on, a woman without no money, Indy, and God goes find somebody in poverty, opposite of society, to bring his glory from? Excuse me, this is qualifying me. I don't care how much money you got or you don't got, God can use you. I don't care what society says about you, God can use you. I don't care what they said about you. I don't care about the neighborhood or community that you came from, and God will use you. All he needs is you to be available. See, me and you keep looking at our weakness, he's looking at your strength. Shout availability. He know your geography. He know where you at relationally. He know what intimacy with you. He know relationally what you're doing. He even know your body type, your identity, and your history. And he still chooses to give you some destiny. Still wants you to see his glory. Still want to choose you to work his ministry. Excuse me. I need to shout loud enough for Satan to hear me. You can't even stop me because God has already chosen me. Don't trip on me, Rod. Read your own Bible. So a broke brother couldn't handle this one. mirror.
Woo! My God.
See, a fixed mindset avoids challenges, but a growth mindset embraces challenges. A fixed mindset gives up early, but a growth mindset keeps on going and stuff gets difficult. A fixed mindset sees effort as a waste of time, but a growth mindset sees it all as a mastery, so I can master how to get here, and if it ever show up again, I got a blueprint to get over it again. To a place where, watch this, a fixed mindset ignores criticism, but a growth mindset says, I will learn from whoever criticized me. Talk about me, but the next time you see me, I still ain't dealing with what you told me. Because I learned from it, grown from it, changed it, and now I'm showing up better than the next time you saw me. Mary! I need an NFL. I need somebody with some availability. Somebody else's success. But a growth mindset says I'm gonna learn from it, and then they're gonna become my inspiration for my own success. I wish you would shout to Jesus, say, help me, Lord.
Help me, Lord.
See, her background becomes a foreground because Mary is a woman who had no authority, no ability. Watch this. Talked about second class in society, and walking in immaturity, young girl, lived in poverty. Watch this. And so when the angel says to her, you favor. She saw, what's scary to me is, she saw an angel, but she couldn't believe his words.
Come on. I got you back today. Come on.
The angel came to her. Hail Mary, you highly favored. Girl, you're favored.
Yes.
You blessed, which means God is favored, you blessed you. Then you're all among all women. Then he says, and you saw him, but she was troubled. Not because if an angel came in here, some of us would run.
Come on.
Mary said, what? But when he opened his mouth and says, you are living below your privilege. You don't know who you are among men. You don't understand that heaven has a definition of you no man could ever give you. She said, watch it. You don't know how the Father sees you. Your problem is you keep living from a human view, not a heaven view. Sometimes what stops us really from operating in our availability is my perception of me, not God's perception of me. Condition, I can't believe that the God of heaven says, you a mighty man.
Oh, yes.
He called him something bigger than what he was in.
Yes.
Tell you, by the way, if you only knew how heaven saw you, you would be shouting right now. Okay, let me give you a quick view. Heaven knew you could be born where you were born and succeed. Heaven knew you could go through the relationships to get you to here and still be a winner. I can't believe God will come for me. I can't believe God will forgive me. I can't believe God will use me. Excuse me, Mary. You can't even have Christmas without you. Christ more. I can't even have Christ more on the earth without you. Do you know anybody could be born right now? Peter could have been born right now. Come on, Paul could have been born right now. Jesus says they can't handle 2016. Let me go give me some.
Wow, my God.
Oh, see, you don't know how to. He already knew his plans for you. I know my plans for you. They were good, not of evil. They bring you to an expected end. You thought that stuff was going to take you out. It couldn't take you out, baby. You got favor on you. You don't even know. You got blessing on you. You don't even know. You don't even know half the jobs you got was me. That was me blessing you, me favoring you, me keeping you, me moving for you. Says availability has to first move beyond your own mentality. She got stuck by what I saw, where I was. So that when God says I'm greater, I couldn't believe I could have it. Say, excuse me, you are so much bigger than where you are. Tell your other neighbor next to you, you're so much bigger than where you are. Tell me, you're so much deeper than where you are.
thinks about us. I might need to deal with some stuff.
Chuck says this, he says, and then he says, first of all, her mentality was messed up, and here's the thing that messed up. It said, fear not Mary. Do you know the angel had to hang out until she got an agreement? So the angel sitting here saying, what will it take to shift your mind to get an agreement with God's mind? Now that means it's parenthetical. Go here. Revelation says to the church of Ephesus, the church of Philippi, and to the angel of those churches. So what God will do is send you an angel to help you get to your process.
And
sometimes he calls them pastors. But anyway, he'll let them hang out with you to help you get to your future. If you listen and be able to get past your mind and get the mind of Christ about who you are, where you are, what God could do with your life in the earth, in spite of your poverty, in spite of your history, in spite of society, in spite of the world. If you believe me, we can do something greater than the earth.
Yes.
Excuse me. I might have to shout right now.
Too many of us are not living our dream because we live in our fears. Too many of us are not living our dreams because we live in our fears. We stuck like Mary right in this one text. She's just stuck for a moment. She'll stay there. Don't let your fear of what could happen make nothing happen. Don't let fear is only a temporary regret that lasts, but regret can last forever. For most of us, everything you want is on the other side of fear. It's all good, treat him a neighbor. Excuse me, I'm wrong. Probably only think from a view of less and settling for lack, the last, the least, and the lowest mindset that you can find. That's the poverty mentality. God wants to use you for his destiny to bring his son to humanity and do his incredible things in your life and with your life. Say hallelujah. And the neighbor, I gotta get my perception of who I am together. I gotta see me like my father sees me. I gotta see what he wants from me. I gotta see myself favored. I gotta see myself blessed. I gotta see myself chosen and set apart for God. You ain't choose me, I chose him. I want you to see yourself like Mary for a moment. God entrusts Jesus in you to be in the earth. He sees you as his conduit to bring Jesus. He sees you as channel to bring the supernatural. Somebody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What messed her up is what, not what she saw, what he said. The announcement messed her up, not the angel.
That's right.
Not his presence, but the promise that he said over her life. I wonder how many promises you heard that messed you up. Mm-hmm. And when somebody says something so great over your life, you stop.
That's true. Yes.
Wow. Yes. I ain't say God stop.
You stop.
Yes. That's good.
Yes. That's good. Wow.
We tend to see weakness where God tends to see strength. We see our infirmities where he sees authority and his ability.
Yeah.
We tend to see the ideal of watch this gap, a product that was better than the manufacturer. We see like a child that was better than a parent. We have like a thing that was made that was better than a maker. So we keep looking for our inadequacies while God's trying to say, can I use you for my glory?
Yeah.
Can you name it? Can you handle what God got to say to you?
Can you handle what God got to say to you?
Sometimes we're so focused on our humanity that we disqualify ourselves from doing great things in here.
Yes.
Somebody shout hallelujah. Second thing he says, not only getting past our mentality is the issue and the ideal of presenting Jesus at this time, particularly when it comes to availability, but once he gets in, he has access to our mind, then he has to deal with our flesh. Oh, don't play with me. Come on. Scripture says after you finally got there, the Bible says this. It says, and behold, she conceived, and you're going to conceive in the womb, bring forth a son. So it's one thing to be able to hear the word come to you. It's another thing for the word to get in.
Yeah, right.
See, Mary is dealing with it coming to her, an angel, but then he sees it now. You conceive, which means come in. See, I heard, I found out something. There's a bunch of people that believe, but not everybody conceives.
Amen.
You do know the difference of conception, right? I told you this before now, when a woman conceives, cycles are break. Mm-hmm. Say it real slow, Pastor, I will. We can tell whether you receive Jesus because cycles breaks in your life.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow.
Thank you, God.
Wow.
We know if you receive a child.
We know if you got the seed of Abraham. We know if you got the seed of Christ. We know if you got the seed of David. We know if you got the seed in you, because it will break the seeds in your life. And though nothing stopped in your life, maybe you just talking. You may know how to, you ain't got church, but you ain't got Jesus. Because something should break. Something should stop. Something should stop flowing. Crazy stuff should fall out of your life. But then also, something should take presence in you. And once a seed comes in, you know what happens when somebody gets pregnant. You know, it's not one person, it's two now.
That's right.
All of a sudden, some cravings begin to hit you. You ain't craved before. Like getting up and going to church on Sunday night. You ain't craved. Come on, stop looking at me like I'm crazy. You like, ain't going to church. All of a sudden, you fall in love with Jesus. Know you forgive him. Know he loves you. Know he took care of you. Know that he's watching over you, providing you, blessing you, healing you, keeping you. You can't keep your family. Know your job. God did all that. Then you realize, oh, church time. Shoot, got to go. Got to go. Got to go. Some stuff got to move better. Yes. Come on, you can tell when move Jesus' presence in my life, he starts changing the shape of your life. Yes. Yes. By the way, are you showing yet? Because you know, if somebody's been pregnant, eventually somebody ought to see the fact that you got somebody in your life. If then nobody see your bump. Of Christ in your life. Because he's in, so he's in me.
He's in me.
Hey, I feel like I have to say it with me. Neighbor. Christ in me.
Christ in me.
It's the hope of glory. Greater is he that's in me. That's in this world. Don't pray with me. I'm talking to you that accepted Jesus Christ. Stop acting like you ain't got nobody in your life. You got somebody in your heart, your mind, and your spirit, and you want to act like it. Most of all, somebody ought to see a book. Your flesh shifts
sometimes.
Something ought to change. Something ought to move. You ought to be able to throw some stuff up. You ought to be getting sick with some stuff. You want to take me out? I ain't got no job. I'm sick. Some stuff just changed on you all of a sudden. I ain't putting up with a whole bunch of food. I don't even know why. Okay. I'm sick of the foolishness. I'm sick of the same thing. I need a new thing. Matter of fact, the Bible says it's called a holy thing. So I'm tired of the old thing. I'm tired of the same thing. I need a holy thing inside of me. And now I'm available. Come on, Jesus. Show up in me. Show up in my mind. Show up in my heart. Show up in my spirit, God. And let somebody else see this Jesus. Oh, yeah. And excuse me. But I don't see him caring enough. You do know when a baby presence takes over the shape of your life, it begins to take your space. All of a sudden, the stuff that you used to be comfortable in, you can't even get comfortable.
That's right. Come on.
You used to lay somewhere, but now you can't lay there. Anymore. You used to go someplace, you can't go there no more. Why? I just. I can beat with you all day, but I can't beat 2 minutes with you no more. No, I'm sick of that. I can't sing that. I'm breaking it. The cycle's broken. I don't need to talk like that. I have a vocabulary, and I actually have a diction. And I got a bunch of more words than curse ones. Yeah, I do. So I'm tired of them, and I got to get around some folks that got some other words too.
Yes!
God.
Yes.
Oh,
how you respond. Did he change your sight? Did he change your emotions? All of a sudden you get sensitive like you ain't never been before. All of a sudden somebody do you wrong, instead of going to hit them, you forgive them. You're like, what the heck is that? What done happened? Yeah. You get it, and you even get like you did good, because then you realize I got to get the forgiveness that I get.
Yeah.
And you just keep right on rolling. They go, what the heck? Is something gonna happen? Or yeah. You know, I just forgave you because I don't even want to stay there, because I got to keep flowing.
Yeah.
Christ in you is the hope of glory.
Yeah.
If somebody's present inside you, it affects your flesh.
Yeah.
Somebody ought to notice that Jesus is present in your life.
Yeah.
Somebody say, I hear this.
I hear this.
This word is so much the ideal that we've been developing and grow. He said they become the ideal of those things. Those who saying that verse, this, and Mary said unto them, the veil of beauty says this, the ideal, it changes her body and everything inwardly about her. Can you imagine Mary about 3 months, 4 months, and that's aside?
Well.
And she rolling like, Jesus got me.
Well.
How's our boldness this Christmas? Just want to check it for a moment. The angel said to her, how should this thing be, seeing that I know not a man? Stop looking here. Stop looking for something human when God wants to do something about it. The angel answered and said, the Holy Ghost will come upon you, and the power of the highest shall overshadow you. That holy thing shall be born of you. It's called the Son of God. Can you excuse me? There is so much room in your life. If you give availability to Jesus. He wants to show up. He wants to show out.
Yes.
He wants to be able to come in, not just come to you. He wants to come in you.
Yes.
Then eventually he wants to come for your life.
Yes.
Somebody will see you.
Amen.
Somebody say
hallelujah.
Say, go ahead and grow.
Go ahead and grow.
And don't be scared and grow.
Don't be scared to grow.
Growth is the only proof that there's life.
Yes.
Growth is the only proof that there's life.
Hallelujah.
If you ain't growing, you dead.
Come on.
You don't know. Growth and comfort can't exist. Growth and comfort can't exist. If you comfortable, you ain't grown. Matter of fact, if it's too convenient for you, it's because you ain't grown. I wish I would talk about stretch marks. I just ain't got the heart. Things that are left because you had to expand to have something else in your life. Oh, come on. I said, sometimes you outgrow folks, you gotta move. Sometimes you gotta make a decision not to be around the same people. And how you know that she had to leave where she had to go find somebody like her, Elizabeth? Because you can't hate, because that's a stretch mark. I gotta leave where I grew up at, leave where I was at, leave where I was comfortable, leave where I was convenient. Everybody know me. Woo-woo, hey, hey, she, hey. Stretch mark. Can you leave where you were? Stretch mark. Can you carry something nobody else can see? Stretch mark. And can you carry it and not sin while you're doing it? Stretch mark.
I like it.
Growth is painful. Change is painful. But ain't nothing more painful than staying the same.
Yes.
I'm gonna leave you alone for 2 minutes. Team your neighbor, you gotta allow. For availability. For the Christ in you. To get beyond you. It's one thing for him to come to us. It's one thing for him to grow in us. But he can't stay inside of you.
Amen.
He's got to get beyond you. Can I ask you something? What's the last thing you've seen God do beyond you? Okay. Where's the last chance you took Jesus where you would never took him before?
Come on now.
Locker room. Family. Neighborhood. Thanksgiving. Y'all have to try to pray over the turkey. You weren't scared, you had to pray like that? Eyes open, talk about that. What they thinking if I ask them to pray? They gonna think you pray.
Right.
And then they
gonna...
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Oh, on your job. You be scared to trust into our job. You go to the job, you look around before you eat. I don't know if I want the Jesus in me to come out of me at my job. I don't know if I can tell him about Sunday at my job. I got it good inside the body at church. But if he gets outside the body of church, then I don't know what to do with my Jesus. Tell your neighbor,
he is helping me today.
But you are only confined to the walls that you build yourself. Mary has availability that receives him, that not only receives him in relationship, but also releases him to the purpose. And I like it because Mary is one of those, one of these new term checks, she's a ride or die. I don't mean no harm, but ain't nobody ride or die like Mary. She was there the first day and the last. Hey Dean, don't play with me. You from the hood with me. Come on. Check. You know what I'm saying? Bam! Ride or die. That's why I had to marry Pastor Bird. Somebody else's life is going to be affected. Father, I pray. And right where we are today, right here in the Spirit of God, you administer to our lives like never before. Our life. God, I don't want another thing, really. I just want Jesus, you to show up and do what you want to do in me, with me, and through me. God, all I want to see is your glory. I want to see that you mature and grow me so that I can give you to somebody else. I want to give them the gift of God, gives eternal life, God. I pray today, wherever we are, if you first call this, if you allow your mentality to stop you from being available, this is your last day. We decree and declare that you have the mind of Christ.
Yeah.